Welcome to the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
Well, if you ask me where I come from, here's what I tell everyone. I was born by God's dear grace in an extraordinary place where the stars and stripes and the eagle fly.
Hello, radio listeners, and welcome to the Conscience of Kansas radio program. My name is Paul A. Ibbetson. I am your host, and you're listening to the fastest-growing, most conservative talk radio in the state of Kansas and beyond. A special shout-out today to all of our Patriot 105.7 listeners. We have another great show for you today. In the first half of the program, we're going to talk about a myriad of Kansas news, including the story of the Lenexa, Kansas 11-year-old boy who cleverly evades an abductor. I'll be giving clear and concise analysis on the Jovan Belcher Kansas City Chief murder-suicide and the Bob Costas attack on the Second Amendment. You'll want to hear that. We're going to have special guest Benjamin Hodge on today to talk about a story of victory here in the state of Kansas. And in the second half of the program, we will have Carrie Brown on to talk about the Branson Cross Project. Have you heard about this? You're going to want to hear it. That and so much more on the little radio program that's not afraid to tackle every liberal in the state of Kansas and always gains yardage for the conservative cause. The Conscience of Kansas radio program is about to begin.
Where the stars and stripes and the eagle fly.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
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 No. Let's break it down. I
would
like
to
buy
Baby.
A.
Hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
It's not damburger, hamburger.
I'm not saying dimburger. I said I would like to buy a damburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy the hamburger.
Hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
Maybe we should stop.
We don't quit. We do not quit. Again.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
I would like to buy the burger.
I would like to buy a hamburger.
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 The burger.
I got my mind set on you.
I got my mind set on you.
And now here is Paul A. Ibbetson, the czar of radio coolness.
All right, so I was like driving to work today on beautiful I-70, my 100-mile jaunt I do to get to Hayes, and lo and behold, a big old giant buck deer out in the middle of I-70 in my lane. It's amazing how your morning can go from thoughts of, what am I going to get done here? I've got to get this done, to, oh my gosh, what's going on? Now, the reenactment there was much more girly than what I was in real life. But man, I mean, those deer on the road, I mean, you gotta do something quick. I took a quick swing of the wheel, managed to go around the deer, and then poof, in a second it's passed. Almost so fast you don't get a chance to be frightened. Then you get a few miles down the road and you're like, oh, you know what I'm talking about. It's all part of living in Kansas and driving these heartland roads. We deal with it. And dealing with Kansas news today, we're gonna talk a little bit about Christmas lights. Do they they offend you? Do they make you unhappy? From the Associated Press, we see that lighting displays can be a nightmare for some neighbors. Huge Christmas lighting displays might be a treat for holiday visitors from other communities to come to watch, but some people don't like it. Now, what they don't like are people standing in their yards to watch other neighbors' displays. People don't like to have the clogged up roads where people are driving very slow. Matter of fact, from this article in the Associated Press, in Prairie Village, Kansas, neighborhood complaints prompted the city council to issue new regulations that essentially forced a man known as Mr. Christmas to unplug a display that had been around for 44 years. Well, look. We are in a free country. If cities want to pass ordinance, people vote on it, and they decide they want to have no Christmas spirit, then fine. But personally, I say, wah, to all you people that are offended by Christmas, there's a whole lot worse spirit out there to be promoting than the Christmas spirit. If you don't like people in your yard, put a fence up. If you don't like people blocking your driveway, put some cones up. It seems ironic that during Christmas, a time when we used to all be nice to one another, where we used to try to take on a happy spirit and be thankful for what we had and to give to others, there's still folks that say, I'm offended by your festive attitude. Didn't they make a story about that? Dr. Seuss, who was that jackwagon that just didn't like that Christmas spirit? In other Kansas news, we see from the Associated Press that an 11-year-old avoids an abduction attempt in Kansas. Lenexa police say a quick thanking 11-year-old boy escaped an attempted abduction. Police say the boy was riding his bicycle Sunday afternoon when a white car drove past slowly and turned around. The boy says the passenger in the car pointed a gun at him and told him to get into his vehicle. Oh my goodness. How many folks out there in Radio Land have ever had someone point a gun at you? I hope the percentage is very low. I have, but I worked on the drug task force. I was a police officer working the streets in the middle of the night. If someone points a gun at you, it changes your world. And so it's amazing the little boy would have the presence of mind. Going back to this article, an ex-police officer Dan Friesen says in a news release that the boy knew he couldn't get into the car under any circumstances, and he ran to a nearby business where they contacted the police. They're still looking for this guy who tried to abduct this boy. It's amazing when you see young people that have the presence of mind. I mean, most adults would just comply, curl up in the fetal position, be totally submissive to someone with a gun. It's understandable. And your boy knew, if I got in this vehicle, I'm not coming back, chances are. And he acted accordingly. This is a good story. It'll only be better when they catch this criminal and prosecute him. In the wake of the Jovan Belcher Kansas City Chief murder-suicide tragedy, folks need to read the article by Rich Lowry in the New York Post. One, because he highlights the attack on the Second Amendment by Bob Costas, who knows nothing about gun rights. He knows nothing about suicide and where that falls in reality. I'll tell you, as a former police officer, I saw lots of suicide, and it is a combination of cowardice and selfishness. It's dirty, it's stinky, it's nasty, and it hurts everyone around the person who does this. We have a murder-suicide in the case of Jovan Belcher. In reality, this is a story about an immature person that had a tantrum when things didn't go his way in life and then decided he did not want to face the consequences of his actions. It is a travesty for everyone around Jovan Belcher. And it's Jovan Belcher's fault, not the NFL, not guns, not anybody else's fault for what happened. All right, we're going to go to commercial break. We'll be right back. And this time I know it's real. Welcome to the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
Hello, this is Satan.
No. Is this Carol Browner?
I am Lucifer, Beelzebub, the King of Darkness, the Dark One.
Hey, since I got you on the line, we've got a running bet down here. Do you write Barack Obama's speeches?
No, I do not interact with the workings of man. Who am I fooling? Yeah, I did help a little bit with the State of the Union speech.
Oh, well, that explains a lot.
And a few of the speeches in the early primary.
Okay, well, that's great. Thanks for stopping.
I also came up with the slogan, Yes, We Can.
Okay, I've got to get on with my show, okay? So we got to sign off.
Oh, and I created the Obama emblem.
Hang up the phone.
Yeah, I did it on a weekend with Hugo Chavez.
Cut the line, cut the line, cut the line.
Man, you can make anything on Photoshop. Look in my eyes.
the cult of personality.
You're listening to the Conscience of Kansas radio program, Politics That Tickle.
Oh, they do. Oh, it's so true. Thank you, Natasha, and welcome everyone back to the program. We're glad you're listening. Hey, have you picked up your brand new Conscience of Kansas radio program and Patriot 105.7 bumper stickers? Man, they are sweet. We'd like to thank the folks at Northwest Signs and Awards at 115 West 8th Street here in Hayes. Mark Pekinick and the folks down there made some really eye-catching, beautiful, patriotic bumper stickers. Come on down to the Hadley Building. Give us an email. You can do that at ibbetsonusa.com. Ask for the bumper stickers. We will give them to you absolutely free. Men out there, young men, single men, college men, young adults, having a Conscience of Kansas radio program bumper sticker and a Patriot 105.7 bumper sticker on your vehicle will automatically and by way of nature make you more attractive to women. Am I overstating the reality? I don't think so. Women out there in America are looking for a sharp man. They're looking for a doer, not a talker when it comes to reality. They're looking for the alpha male of the pack. And those that have the Conscience of Kansas radio program and our Patriot stickers on the back, they say, I got my stuff together. I take care of business. I am a real man. Women sense it, they acknowledge it, and they will respond. Now, ladies, what do you get when you have our bumper stickers on the back of your vehicles? I will talk about that on another show when I highlight the reality of an increased resale value on your vehicles once our bumper stickers are affixed to your truck, van, car, tractor, combine, you name it. We'll talk about that in the future. All right, let's go to my interview with Benjamin Hodge from Overland Park at this time. All right, radio listeners, today we have a return guest in Benjamin Hodge. Benjamin is out of Overland Park, Kansas, and he covers a lot of interesting Kansas news, really issues that are germane, really across the gambit. And Ben, we'd like to welcome you back to the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
Thank you, Paul. I always enjoy it.
Well, it's interesting and fun, and lately there hasn't been a whole lot of happy political news bouncing around the country, and you've got a story today that is a Kansas story, a county commission story, and a happy story, and I was wondering if you could tell our radio listeners a little bit about it.
Yeah, my political action committee got involved in one race this year, and it was a county commission race in Johnson County. In Johnson County, I'm not saying it's any better than any other county, but it is a very large county, and it's they consider it to be the economic engine of the state. And so what happens there is it's not any more important than elsewhere, but it is. I do believe it is noteworthy. And so our county has about 500 to 600,000 people, and there's seven county commissioners, and each district has, it's larger than a state senate district in the state of Kansas. There's about 50,000 voters and 70,000 to 80,000 people in each district. I had helped elect two conservatives out of to back up 2 or 3 years ago, there were zero conservatives on the seven-member county commission, and we helped elect two conservatives 2 years ago. And then this year, we got involved in a race where it was roughly tied 2 years ago. A liberal beat a conservative by about 50 votes. It was very, very close. Back in 2008, 4 years ago, I should say. So this was a rematch with the same people from 4 years ago where it was tied roughly 50-50 4 years ago. And the liberal beat the conservative by about 50 votes. Well, this time, the conservative won by 67%. His name is John Toplikar, and he beat the incumbent, a guy named Calvin Hayden. And there are a few things that were remarkable about this. One is just the fact that he won. Two is that the margin by which he won. And to look at the margin, to compare, he beat Mitt Romney in that area. Mitt Romney got 61% of the vote in this part of our county. Countywide, Mitt Romney won 57% of the vote. In this particular district, Romney won 61%, where this county commission candidate, the conservative, won 67%. So he even outperformed Mitt Romney. And then third, I want to mention that the liberal outspent him 13-1. The liberal raised $26,000, and the conservative candidate raised $2,000.
Wow.
So where you run as a conservative, I do believe conservatives can win almost anywhere. And actually, I should say also that what's unique about our races here is that they're nonpartisan, meaning there's no Republican or Democrat on the ballot. So when you look at the name on the ballot, it only says the name and the name of the person in the city. It doesn't say the party affiliation. Mm-hmm. So there's actually two Republicans running against one another. And there's some very good irony in this. It was actually liberal Republicans back in 2000, 12 years ago, that actually made our races nonpartisan. It's in kind of our county. It's called the county charter. It's like a constitution for our county. So it's more or less locked in place right now that our races are nonpartisan. And it was actually done by liberals who were concerned that conservatives were taking over the party back in 2000. and they were correct that that was happening. Mm-hmm. But they were trying to prevent that happening at the county level. Well, what's funny is conservatives have actually used that to our advantage and actually gone to Democratic doors and independent voting doors. And we go and if you go and talk about issues, what you find is that the conservative Republican actually agrees with Democrats more than moderate Republicans. What I just said is considered radical by moderate Republicans. So let me rephrase that. The positions of conservative Republicans are actually in agreement with Democrats more than the moderate Republicans. Democrats agree with property rights, Paul. Democrats agree with voting before you increase property taxes. They may disagree on how much you want property taxes to be increased, but they don't mind a vote on that matter. They want, if your house is going to be taken by eminent domain, they would agree with conservatives that the Constitution would declare that to be illegal if it's to just give that, take it by eminent domain and then give it to another developer for private use. So what this candidate, the John Toplikar, that my political action committee supported, and he ran a very good race himself, to be clear. So, I mean, I'm not taking credit for it. We helped him improve his margin. He was probably going to win anyway, to his credit. What he did was talk about issues, and the conservative issues ended up winning over not only Republican voters, but also independent and Democratic voters.
Well, that's interesting, and I'm definitely digesting that last part you said about the conservatives and the liberals, but what do you think were the main factors? I'm always interested in stories where conservatives have won in areas where they've had trouble, or there's been a long lineage of liberal dominance, because I want to know the equation necessary to replicate that. What do you think was the biggest factor between last time and this time to have such a big swing?
You need a good candidate, first of all. I mean, mm-hmm. Not just any candidate can win anywhere. But that said, an average person is a good enough candidate. You don't need a... I do believe almost any of your listeners should consider running for office. I believe almost any of your listeners would make excellent candidates. You have to be willing to go door to door. You have to be willing to talk to people. You have to be willing to raise a little money. You don't have to raise an outlandish amount of money, but you have to be willing to raise a little money so you can pay for professional looking yard signs and flyers. And what you don't want to do is just do what the establishment does. The establishment in this race ran the same race that they've been running for the last 15 to 20 years, pre-internet, what I would call, where they did was send a flyer out. The liberal opponent was endorsed by at least three major mayors. The three state senators that represent that area. The three state senators that represent that area were endorsing the liberal incumbent, and same with the major mayors in the area. And the voters just flat out did not care. I don't even know if they looked at the postcard, to be honest. I think mail matters less than it used to. But to be clear, mail still matters, but what you say on it matters. And so you have to be willing to actually articulate a message. If you just go out and say, look how important I am, I think we fool ourselves sometimes as Republicans. We tell ourselves we believe what the media is telling us and saying our message is radical, when in fact a conservative, fiscal conservative / libertarian message, what I mean by that is government needs to leave us alone. Mm-hmm. That type of message is the mainstream message. So if you go out and articulate that and say that you're going to stand for that message, I believe that the voters will be appealed. That the voters will flock to that message.
I certainly believe it, and ever so much in Kansas. Now, lately, Ben, I haven't been batting 1,000% after walking out of this presidential election, what I thought was going to take place. But certainly in Kansas, the data that's coming out on election time, whether it's on the president or on local issues, local candidates, going all the way back to the last primary, you can see that people in Kansas want to have those conservative values. And if you can articulate them properly, you can win. And it is a place where you don't have to raise the amounts that you see for president as far as funds. We get lost in that, thinking that's the cure-all. You can have a huge bankroll, and if you squander it, you're going to lose.
Welcome back to the Conscience of Kansas radio program with Paul A. Ibbetson.
Thank you, Emily, and welcome everyone back to the program. As always, we're glad to have you listening. Are you out there getting ready for Christmas, doing that shopping, trying to find gifts for family and friends? Well, if you've got a conservative friend out there here in the state of Kansas or one of our heartland states, you ought to get them a copy of the Kansas Tea Party documentary film. It is the only documentary film of its kind that highlights the Kansas Tea Party, its struggles, its victories, the challenges for the future. You can get it at Amazon.com. You can buy and send them a copy, or you can send them a download rental where they can watch it for 7 days. It's much cheaper to do that if you like. Either way, you're sharing the Tea Party, you're sharing the Kansas Tea Party, and you're giving a great gift to a friend this season. All right, let's go to my interview with Carrie Brown talking about the Branson Cross Project. All right, radio listeners, today we have a special guest in Carrie Brown. Carrie Brown is executive director of the Branson Cross Project. They're in beautiful Branson, Missouri. And Carrie, we'd like to welcome you to the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
Well, thank you very much, Paul. I appreciate it.
I was mentioning a little bit before we got started here that I have lived most of my life in Montgomery and LeBec County, right in the corner, the southeast corner of Kansas. And for folks down there, if you want to go on vacation, you either go to Tulsa, Oklahoma, or you go to Branson. That's really where you get away. And so I've been to Branson many times. It is so beautiful country down there. So many nice things to see and a mecca for lots of people. And you've got this interesting project you guys are doing. Could you tell us about the Branson Cross Project?
Absolutely. Well, this was born out of a vision I think will probably appeal to you and your listeners, particularly with what's going on today in America with the political environment. But, you know, there's been some question on, are we a nation under God? And there are some individuals that got together and said, you know, we don't feel as individuals we can do very much about this. Maybe as a group together we can get something going and challenge that thought that we're no longer a nation under God. And I think out of that was born Branson Cross. And what it is we've gotten together with people from all different religious backgrounds and beliefs, anyone who names the name of Jesus Christ. And as a group, we've said that we want to, in the heartland of America, erect a 200-foot-tall cross on the second tallest mountain in the Ozark Mountains. It's just 6 miles north of Branson, Missouri, right off U.S. Highway 65 that has 8 million people pass by it annually. And that cross will have twin elevators that you'll be able to go up to the 17-story horizontal cross beam, get out and see the story and recreation of Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection. And the best part about this entire venue is that it will be absolutely free admission. There will be no charge for sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Wow, that is great. You don't have to go very far from that area for folks in Kansas and folks in Missouri to go to, like, St. Louis to see the St. Louis Arch, and what an interesting piece of construction it is, how you can see it from a great distance. I would love the idea, and I really think it's monumental to have a structure of large size, something that will draw people in from many different states that has a pro-Christian message there, as the cross does. Now, I'm sure you've probably had some people that don't want that to go in. There's some people that are offended. Have you had much opposition?
No, not really. We've, and whatever opposition there has been, I mean, you know, it's not our job to focus on the negative. It's our job to, you know, sidestep that and keep pushing forward for the kingdom. And This is something that we see as a true kingdom legacy project where all of his children can get together and, you know, with their involvement, through their testimony, say, you know, Jesus has made, you know, a tremendous difference in our lives when he came into our hearts and he recreated us. And that's kind of where we're coming from it. We just kind of sidestep the stuff and just keep pushing forward.
Well, that's good. And I want to focus on the positive as well. But I think you're correct when you start out with saying that there are attacks on Christianity, there is a movement in society, in American culture, that's been moving away from God. I certainly believe that. And you get these forces that don't want to see something like this come up. And I just wondered whether or not there's folks out there saying, you know, you're offending us and we're going to try to shut you down. If you don't have it, great. And superseding that and going forward is what you have to do as well. The positive thing that can come from something like this is amazing. Where are you guys at in the developing stages?
Well, actually, we own the original property that has the top of the hillside, and have owned it for several years. We've gone through planning and zoning, and we've gotten variances to build to the entire 200-foot height and also setback variances. The footprint of this building is going to be 30 feet by 30 feet, going all the way up 200 feet. And then the cross-section of the horizontal crossbar is also going to be 30 by 30. So it's a fairly, you know, spectacular, project to do. And where we're at currently is, originally we had been looking at this, and conservatively we figured that after we had possession of the land and the property, we were looking at about a $15 million project.
Wow.
And nobody really, really wanted to hear that number. I mean, that is a big, awesome number. It's a lot of money. But the beautiful thing about it is when we really got focused and started going, I hate to say it, but because it sounds cliche, but the Lord sent someone who showed up one day. We didn't invite him. We didn't know who he was, but he showed up and he brought actual construction plans. Somebody else had been thinking about this.
Wow.
And we gave him portions of the vision that we knew that nobody else did, and asked him to look at it. And it turns out that this gentleman, his ministry is, he literally builds $20 to $25 million church buildings all across the United States. And he called me back 10 days later, which was the day after Easter 2010. And he said, "You've got your figures wrong." And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, it's going to cost more. He said, "We can do this project for between a third and a fifth what your projected cost was."
Wow.
And I was flabbergasted. I said, "Did you just tell me you could build this cross for between $3 and $5 million? And he said, "Yeah." And I'm a guy that if I come into a community and the community's not the one that's building it, I think that's a slap in the face. This guy came from outside the community because he had special technical knowledge. And I said, you know, I want to pump money into the community and help the economy here. So I'm a little bit hesitant. He says, "I'll use whoever you want to do it." So that answered my concerns about the situation, because here, you know, God sent this guy. You know, he reduced the price from $15 million to between $3 and $5 million, you know, automatically, which was the hand of God.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be back with more Kerry Brown and the Branch and Cross Project in a moment.
Welcome back to the Conscience of Kansas radio program with Paul A. Ibbetson.
Thank you, Emily. Welcome, everyone, back to the program. Let's get back to my interview with Kerry Brown, talking about the Branson Cross Project.
Mm-hmm. And I can use the people in the local community at least so much as possible to build the actual project and you know, rejuvenate and work on the local community. So it's just an incredible blessing and a fantastic position to be. May of this year, we had been, 3.5 years ago, there was an additional piece of property that had direct access to the top of the hillside. We would have been forced to build a road up a 35-degree incline, which probably by itself, the road itself would have cost between three-fourths and maybe even $1 million just to build the road so that we could get construction equipment to the top of the hill. Well, there was this additional 13 acres of property that was right next to us, and it already had access, but it was listed at $3.3 million 4 years ago. And we began to pray and believe God that property would come into our hands. Well, in May of this year, we purchased that property for just over one-tenth of that original value.
Wow.
And, you know, you look at this and it's like, you know, I'm an attorney by trade. I'm used to doing things by the sweat of the brow and working it out with my own hands and stuff like that. But you know what? If I had had to get between 10 and 12 million extra dollars to build this, and then an additional $3 million to buy the property, as opposed to what actually happened, which was the Lord doing it.
Right.
To where I didn't even have to do that. I mean, he trimmed down on the top of the project down. So, you know, there's a scripture that says that unless the Lord builds a house, we build in vain. And there's also another one that says that he gives us the ability to create wealth without sorrows.
Right.
Sorrows in that case means without toil. Well, you know what? I didn't have to toil for at least $13 million.
Wow.
In a period of 3 years. I've never been a millionaire before, but boy, I tell you, when he does something like that, it makes you feel like a billionaire, and you just want to jump on board and get involved.
Well, it's phenomenal stuff happening at a tremendous scale. It's hard for a lot of folks, even myself, to really visualize what this is going to look like when it's done and the scale that it'll be at. Is there any projected date when this will be completed?
Well, actually, we're in a position right now where this was a project that it was never intended for a small town like Branson of 10,000 people to pay for and fund and build this.
Mm-hmm.
This was something that, you know, I truly feel that if even one person or five people or 10 people got together and did this, that that's not what the Lord wants. He is a God of fellowship with him and a God of fellowship with each other. He wants all of his kids involved. And so, you know, we've gotten to this particular place where we now have both of these properties. We're literally ready to begin building the foundation and putting this up. And I really believe that if we get a good start at construction and at building the foundation here at the beginning of this next year, that we can have this up between 6 months and a year.
Wow.
So literally 2013, we could have this up. We probably wouldn't have it to the level of having people to go up in it yet.
Mm-hmm.
It would probably take a full year to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, that's all dependent on, you know, the funding, on the involvement of people, you know, going forward. And so that's kind of, you know, going into this, the end of the year season, we've been trying to reach out, get the word out about this project, and ask people that there are corporate people out there. There are people who, you know, are captains of industry, and they definitely could use, I'm sure, you know, the tax benefits of donating to a project like this,
mm-hmm.
you know, from both an individual and a corporate standpoint.
Yeah.
And also, I mean, we've really left it open so that people who want to give a dollar or $5 or they want to donate because they want to memorialize a family member who is special to them or a church organization. You know, we have on our website, www.bransoncross.com, you know, different levels of recognition where people can actually buy pavers, you know, for, you know, relatively inexpensively. And these pavers will actually be around the base of the cross when it's built. And so the light of this cross, which will be the largest walk-through cross in the world, will be shining down on that loved one or that one that they want to memorialize. And I just love that thought.
Give the website out again where folks that want to help, whether it's monetarily or get with you to help in other ways that they can do so.
That website, again, is www.bransoncross.com. There is also, they can also get there if they Google images at the cross. That also works. www.imagesatthecross.org is the same website, so they can get there either way.
Well, that sounds great. And Kerry Brown, we really appreciate your time. I'm excited about this project. I just learned about it a few days ago. And this is from someone who's, you know, been down to Branson many times and love that area. Would love to take my family and friends down there and just enjoy that. And we're going to put the links up for folks at our master website for our radio listeners at IbbetsonUSA.com so they can find that. We also have some very interesting television spots where they talk about this and cover you on that so folks can get a feel for what's going on. Life is fleeting. You have a chance in life to do some good on this earth, and money comes and goes. And so if you want to take that money and invest it in something that's going to have a positive, lasting impact on a lot of people, this is a great opportunity for people. Whether they're giving a small amount or giving a lot, I would encourage people to really look in to this project. And Kerry Brown, do you have any parting thoughts before we sign off with you today?
Actually, I do. Just a short one. You know, it occurred to me in Scripture, and something that I really loved was that, you know, we see over and over in Scripture how people, the Lord leads them into the desert. He led the Israelites into the wilderness. He led the Apostle Paul after his conversion into the desert of Damascus for 3 years. He even led Jesus into the desert for 40 days. And people ask, well, why does he do that? Well, those people didn't go into the desert alone. And I think what I never understood really as a young, immature Christian was that there is a friend who sticks closer than a brother, and that is Jesus and the Holy Spirit that comes and resides within us. And it says in James 4:5 that the Holy Spirit is like a jealous lover. Mm-hmm. He wants to get us alone. So he leads us out into the wilderness and into the desert. And what happens? Well, all of the things that are us, all of our resources, all of our things that we rely on begin to fall away.
Mm-hmm.
And so that the only thing we can rely on is that lover that we have followed out into the desert. And I say that to say this, you know, just as the Israelites were led out into the desert and Jesus and Paul, they all came out of the desert, but they came out transformed. They came out different. Our country is being led into the desert at this time. And the funds and the things that we rely on in day-to-day life that are not of Christ, that are not of our lover, those things are going to begin to fall away. And we're going to have a choice of whether we turn and we look at him and we find out who he is and we follow him through the desert and allow him to minister to us and allow him to provide for us and allow him to take care of us, or we die in the desert.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, people in a desert, they'll drink any type of water if that's all they have. They'll drink the water that the animals have urinated in or that's been poisoned if they get thirsty enough. You know, we will drink the poison of a fallen culture or a fallen world. But somehow, some way, people will always know fresh, pure water of life when they see it. And that's what I'm really hoping that by putting a cross in the heartland of this nation, in the heartland of America, just as the tabernacle was built in the heart of the people of Israel out in the wilderness, that people will see Christ in it. They will look up and they will look for him and they will let him lead them through this time.
Kerry Brown from the Branson Cross Project, folks, check it out today. And Kerry, we just want to thank you for taking time out to speak to the folks here in Kansas on the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
I appreciate it so much, Paul.
We'd like to thank all of our special guests that came on the show today. And as always, we'd like to thank you, the radio listener, whether you're in Kansas or any of the other states in our fine union. Thank you for tuning in every day from 5 to 6 p.m. on the Patriot 105.7. Or if you're clicking the Listen Live button in the upper left-hand corner at IbbetsonUSA.com and listening to us through our internet streaming anywhere in the country, anywhere in the world, we really appreciate it. Or if you are listening to the archives of the Conscience of Kansas radio program at IbbetsonUSA.podomatic.com, if you're one of our 500,000 subscribers and growing, thank you, thank you, thank you. I can't really say it enough how much I appreciate you listening to the show and telling your family and friends about the program and where they can listen to it. Man, it's great out there. We're working hard every day, fighting for conservative values, and you make it possible. You make it happen. My name is Dr. Paul A. Ibbetson. You've been listening to the Conscience of Kansas radio program. We'll be talking to you soon.